Making a life worth living and retirement worth having is about the people in our lives. It's not about how we handle our time management. It's literally about employment and the areas of work that we use our professional skill sets in. It's also about the career applications and aptitudes that we have and literally the professionals that we network with along the way. You see, in life, we have moments of time to make a difference for people. We have moments of time to give them kindness. We have moments of time to pass them a can of food that has been untainted by any other hands, at least we assume in theory, based on how our food responsibilities are handled by major corporations. But in reality, what we're talking about in life is whether or not we take time to get to know people. Do we get to know them soulfully? Do we get to know them spiritually? Do we get to know them personally? Do we get to know them professionally? How intimately do we get with them in our conversations? If we literally talk about child rearing, if we actually talk about other aspects of life, such as loving and other things, then that's sort of an intimate sort of relationship. If we profess to know God and we say that we're a Christian, then literally we have to kind of produce that in our lives in some way that we walk, talk, and move through the world. The reality is there are many people who profess to be a person of spirituality or faith, but they don't always practice their faith in every moment of time. They don't usually stop, pause, pray, and then present a response. They often just let it wing. They let it fly. They let it throw across the room, and they don't think about what they're doing in relationship to the God in heaven. They don't usually step back and go, okay, if God's looking down on me from heaven, and he is practically the creator of everything that I own and possess in my life, and all the relationships that I have I been doing the right things in order to produce the loving relationship I need in my life, or have I been sitting idle and not going out and making new liaisons and contacts to produce for me a new life, a new way of being, a new way of thinking, a new way of making sure my energy and my soul and my spirit is soaring in the Lord's grace, in his kindness, in his prosperity, opportunities, and in the generosity of my own soul? Am I producing caring, loving actions to help other people in need? Am I producing a world with my own little bit of reactivity or activity that helps the world to produce more peace in it? Or am I violently reacting towards other people's rights to communicate, rights to report news, rights to report truth, rights to report observations, whether they are real or not, is in their minds, what some person I knew once said to me, but I really wanted to smack him for that, because people have true experiences. They have real experiences with real people, and real experiences with real facts, and real experiences with real evaluations of people who have no rights in their life. But it's true. People judge others. They do it instantaneously. They do it in about 3 seconds flat, we know, in marketing, and frankly, that's not always fair. Sometimes people dress a certain way, sometimes people look a certain way, because they're in the process of helping a corporation to understand literally who their employees are. There's also people who go in looking absolutely normal, and they don't recognize that those people are reporting back to their companies every little bit of the experience they had with their employees, especially those in positions of powers, especially those in positions to turn things on and turn things off and improve in a way that's important to their own professional careers. You see, most people in a retail job don't really think about how many opportunities they have to network with the people who come in, who literally proactively go into their place and say, I'm looking for this, that, and the other thing. It's a wonderful opportunity not only to represent your firm, but it's also a wonderful opportunity to represent your own skill sets that hopefully you are producing in your own way to improve your aspects of life, because not everyone wants to stay in a particular hourly job forever. People like to move from hourly positions after they've kind of timed out of that in their area of life or their age limit of life, and then they want to move into a position with a salary, with benefits, with opportunities for advancements, with career opportunities, with possibly company cars and other little benefits that go along with getting beyond the teenage and 20-something aspect of life. You see, that's what happens, is if we don't start to make life plans, if we don't have people interfering with our life plans, then we really move forward. But if we have people impeding us, if people taking our technology, if we have people thinking they have lawful rights to ruin a life, then it's sort of hard for those people to go on. We also have people who have challenges. They face difficulties. They have parents who are elderly they have to care for. And I remember sitting in a Walmart on a couple occasions, and there's an elderly woman who is clearly in a situation of having a lot of difficulties with something like Parkinson's, but not exactly, but she's openly looking for, how do I help my mom and go do the shopping? She leaves her mom at the front near the lavatories, and she goes off and shops. It's a little bit easier for her because it's harder for her to push her mom or let her mom drive through Walmart, I guess. Or maybe her mom doesn't like shopping. It's hard to say, but she literally sits there alone. I feel bad about that. I talked to her a little bit, but I can't tell if she can really fully function mentally because she hasn't responded a lot, and I don't want to be someone who's seen as a predator just talking to someone. But in life, we have to talk to people. We have to get out there. We have to mix and mingle. We have to change our mindset about people, and we literally have to prove, not only to our own selves, but to people that we interact with, that we're not out there monstrously trying to put our beliefs and our systems and our thinking and our ideologies and our ideas about the world and how God looks at the world on other people. And that's the dangerous game that a lot of people of faith play, that they literally think that if they do one little thing outside of their comfort zone, that maybe they're pissing off God, or that God is angry at them for something they feel or something they do or something they do in private. And frankly, that's literally between them and God. The people who go into places and make righteous statements about other people are really not in the life of God. They are producing a favoritism in their own minds, that they are favor over other people, and that's not true. The Lord God loves us all. He made us all. He created us all. He knows all our crap and our things going on, and I've edited that a little bit. But the truth is that in a pastoral role, we have to talk like real people. We have to understand that once people leave the church, they swear, they cuss, they carry on, they talk about inappropriate topics like politics, sex, and money with people they don't know that well, they don't trust that often, and frankly, that's the truth. We have to take risks in life. We have to get out there, we have to mix and mingle, as I said, and when we do that, we find out who's who. The only way to find out who someone is to talk to them for a little bit of life, and when you talk to them long enough, at some point the Lord says, it's time to go. And when you hear that little message, then it's literally time to go. When you don't listen to that small voice, or when you hear that shouting voice saying, fire him, or whatever, and you don't do it, you lose opportunities, you lose rights to protect yourself, and you literally lose the right to get away from the monsters who lie, steal, and cheat people out of their lives. They cheat people out of information. They take that information to other sides, they take that information to competitors, they take that information and go sell it on their own, and that's what people do. They harm people's rights to their intellectual property, their copyright on property that they've created and they've intellectually been gifted by the Lord, and that's an abomination to the Lord. But people don't think about that. When they steal physical property, they think they're doing the Lord's bidding in some regard, I guess, but that's not really true. Now, when I talk about real life, when I talk about real things, that is what people care about. You see, people really care about their personhood, their rights to their own bodies, their own beings, their own souls, their own minds, their own intellects, their own psyche, their own every physical aspect of their self, especially in the areas of intimacy. Now, they also care about their property. They care about their car. They care about their home. They care about their possessions. They literally care about all those things unless they're going through a loss, and then they might leave them in a bin for a long period of time and just let them sit until they decide how they want to lay out their house when they're feeling more up to it. Some people battle illness and they don't have the energy to do everything, which is absolute truth. Some people make a mess in their homes and then can't face the mess they've literally created, or the hoarding that they do, or the stuff that they've collected they really don't need and really should donate to charity in behalf of the God in heaven. But that's true. Now, when it comes to our paperwork, that's another area of legality. You see, people do care legally about their bank accounts, about their tax records, about their rights to get mail sent to them in their own personal name or business name, and yet there are people out there who play the game of I'm God and I'm going to send stuff to people and make this their new address, and that's not their lawful right. It's really not their right to play that game. Now, when we want to give feedback to a company, it's really hard to do. We are asked all the time to fill out these surveys, but some of them are such a joke because they actually request that you give them the receipt number, the date, the time, and everything about when you visited, which literally allows them to look you up on a camera probably in the restaurant to see how it really went. But how a person feels about an experience is not the same as how someone particularly observes a situation through a camera that's being utilized illegally or possibly illicitly, meaning that we don't know it's there, in a way to produce a harm. I pretty much know that there's retail establishments that put in these fire alarm cameras that actually there's a fire alarm in a private area and there's a camera in it. Now, if they do that to protect themselves against employee theft or other little things, I get that. But they have no right to put that into a lavatory where people are exposing themselves privately in a moment to relieve themselves. And that's something that we really need to think at. I also want to know about these automated things. These automated things in the bathrooms are really frustrating as hell for most people. I literally had a father who had a lot of problems with his bladder. And when there is no paper towels in the bathroom because companies are trying to cut back on expenses, it puts people who are out and not prepared or simply have run out of things at a great disadvantage. That used to be a loving kindness that companies did, was to provide them with paper towels and other things, because I can remember my father had a blowout one day and it was horrid. And I literally had to use my handkerchiefs, I had to use my t-shirt, I literally had to use all sorts of things just to clean him up so that he would have the dignity to walk out of that restaurant without a problem. It was a day that my mom was there, but I just said, "Mom, I'll handle it. I'll totally handle it." And I did. And I just lovingly took care of wiping him up. But there was no paper towels in the bathroom. It's not true. Thankfully, there was. But these automated toilets, what are they seeing? What are they photographing when we sit our butts down on those things in a private moment? Are we being photographed, or are privates being given out to people through those video cameras? Are they given back to the company so they can study how people utilize their devices? I mean, let's really get real. I get annoyed as hell in the bathroom when I want to wash my hands. Not only have I seen many employees who handle food come into the bathroom, use the toilet, and then not wash their hands, which frustrates the hell out of me. Now, maybe there's a sink in the kitchen, fine, but still, when a company is employing people to handle food and there's a customer in the bathroom, that employee better damn well wash their hands in front of that customer. It creates a safety and sanitation violation of epic legal proportions, I'm pretty sure. But, you know, that's just me being a little bit litigious and a little bit kind of preventive maintenance. You see, I worked in the Japanese manufacturing plant. The entire aspect of GOES and all the other aspects of TQM and SPS and all the things that we learned in QS 9000 and QS 15000 and all the different aspects of quality control is you've got to prevent the problems from happening. You've got to anticipate what could possibly happen and how can we fix this. Now, we all have those little voices that says, don't go there. And then we all have these big, bold voices that say, go on, give it another try. Give it one more good old college try to see if you can win someone's heart, mind, and soul to your proposition. And that sometimes puts us at risk, because sometimes those people won't even tolerate the first question, let alone the last, and they put people in jeopardy when they start to illicitly, immorally go after them with people who are not involved at all in that relationship. And that's something we have to really look at in today's society, as are we creating peace? Are we making peace? Are we producing prosperity for all? Or are we just producing prosperity for some because technology companies decide who they're going to help? They have the right to do that. Companies have the right to decide who they're going to serve. But when companies, like some of the ones I went to today, think they can just illegally record people and then pretend like nobody's listening to those files, that is immoral. It is highly immoral, especially if that person is feeding the local force. That's not right. It's something funny if they're going to promote Star Wars and then they're basically monstrously demonstrating other people. That's not lawful. It's not spiritual. It's not soulful. And I'm pretty sure Jesus would be pissed off about being a person of interest today. But he was a person of interest in the old days, and that's something we have to look at, is how was his person of interest like? He literally went from town to town. He went from synagogue to synagogue. He went from home to home. He lived with people he didn't know all that well. He got help. He got food. He raised the dead. He literally got touched by his clothes, by people who had such faith, and they were healed. And that's the way it went in the old days. But today, where are the miracles? Where are the prophets? Where are the mystics? Where are the metaphysics? Where are the people who know the energy of the Lord is incredibly magical? And that's what we want to talk about today. We want to talk about today that the magic of the Lord is something else. It is incredible. It is more than we can possibly imagine. But when people get involved with tampering with the magic, meaning they try and say it doesn't exist, they try and say that he's not really present in our lives, they try and say that angels and Holy Spirit doesn't actually surround us and protect us, they have no way to prove it. But there are ways to prove that there is a God. And that's been proven almost scientifically, down to that concept of artificial intelligence, not at all, to the architect or the magnificent design. I'm trying to remember the name of what it was, but, you know, intelligent design, I believe, is what the principle was. That was nearly proven down to the umpteeniest of degree in science. And that's fascinating. But there are other ways to prove it, and churches and pastors need to start to get on board with some of the Eastern religions. Now, openly, we have to finish up this little podcast because I might be expecting a visitor, but I'd like to say that in the world we have peacemakers and troublemakers. Peacemakers go the distance. They try as many times as they possibly can to create peace by paying attention to what's important to the individual. Not what's important to them in that moment of time, but what's important to the individual they're trying to create peace with. Sure, feeding people is important. Yes, housing them is also important. But literally saying, where is this soul supposed to go based on the Lord's plan for their life, is the utmost degree of peacemaking in the land. And sometimes people miss out on it because they're so busy looking at the wrong things in life and they're not putting the focus on the soul in the other aspects of the Lord's plan for people. This is Blake Ensign of Blaze Communications LLC talking about the magic and mayhem of God's house. And that's what I'm sticking to. Thanks for listening.